my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore.
Sisters, come on down to that river. Guaranteed you'll never be There's revival and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. A Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it?
Thank you, Scott. I like that little flourish at the end. Yeah, very good. That sounds nice. Well, welcome in the name of Jesus Christ. And to y'all who are streaming in, welcome. I'm glad you're with us this morning on a cloudy western Pennsylvania Sunday. But it's not temperature's not too bad today. So glad that you're with us. Now, we got some announcements in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. Studies at 10 o'clock. Remember, our Wednesday studies 10 o'clock this week. And the Thursday evening, 6:30. So you're invited to come to those. Remember, coming up, we've got the Easter egg hunt on the 23rd. And it's not just going to be hunting for eggs. We're going to have drawing, coloring stuff, and games. It's going to be, it is the place to be. So, and maybe from what I understand, the big bunny may be here as well. From what I understand, I'm hearing rumors of that effect. So if you know some children that might enjoy doing this, being involved in it, please invite them. Okay? Yes. So candy, and also in your bulletin, you've got the opportunity to sign for Easter flowers, so make the place look pretty. So you wanna do that. You can also pass this on to someone else who may be interested in doing it. Now, we've got some information about the painting class. Diane, You're going to paint. And what are you going to paint? You're going to paint a picture. So I'm having deja vu. Didn't we have this same conversation last week? Yeah. See, now you've elaborated on it. So it's, what's that? Yeah, that's right. Hanging on to that Q-tip. But what makes it really cool is you're going to be doing it with Q-tips. So that'll be really neat. And remind me, what is the date? The 15th. Okay, and lunch is going to be provided. I don't know what it is, but it'll be something wonderful. Any other announcements that anybody here might have? Yes, Tammy.
Mm-hmm. The other thing is, I felt to mention last week that we get 4 Del Rosso all-day park tickets for the Splash Laguna and the park. And after talking to a few people, I believe that anyone who sells, and your name is on that selling sheet, that you are a seller for the Hokies, we are going to put them on a wheel and do a drawing and let that person, unless anybody else has a better idea, that person who sold Hokies, no matter if you sold 2 or 200.
Or 200, right. To get the 4 tickets.
And if we do sell 250 items, which I really hope that we do, we also get $25 off as a first-time customer of Del Rosso's, the church.
Okay, so that's pretty exciting.
So I think, unless anybody has a better idea, I think that spinning the wheel and giving everybody the same chance that sold, as opposed to not knowing what to do with mm-hmm.
Sounds good. Instead of it being like a wheel of fortune, it'll be a wheel of hoagie. That's pretty good. Yeah, but pretty good. Outstanding. Thank you. Anything else? Oh, yeah, Karen.
There are Lenten luncheons being served in Reimersburg.
Right.
Wednesdays at noon.
Right.
And so far, Paul and I have been the only ones from this church representing our church, so we'd love to have you come and join us at 12 o'clock at the former Methodist church. It's called Faith Fellowship.
Right. And it's a good lunch. It's a good lunch.
It's a devotional time out.
Right. And I hear outside of one devotional that was iffy. Most of the devotionals have been really good.
They've all been good so far.
Well, I was talking about the one. I was going to say that was the one I did. That was. But it is good. A good fellowship, a lot of people. So that was. Thank you, Karen. That's a nice thing to do. Yes. You know, we have several birthdays that are coming up. Marcy. Your birthday is soon, right? Coming up soon. And Miss Meyer, your birthday is coming up soon. Your birthday was yesterday. Yeah, I'm looking at last week's bulletin. which kind of explains why I've got, I don't have this week. Somebody hand me this week's. Thank you, Scott. Now you have no idea what you're playing, right? That's always good. Yeah, thank you. You've got numbers written on this. Yes. And some good gossip. I'll have to talk to you about this later. I didn't realize this. So, okay, yeah, your birthday's over. So you're yesterday's news. But Marcy's is here. And Debbie, your birthday is coming up? Really? Wow. Well, does anybody know, does Amazon deliver, does one day delivery? Can they do one day? One day? Okay. Well, I think it would be appropriate since two such illustrious deacons are celebrating a birthday this week. I think it'd be appropriate to sing. So let's. Very, very good. Any other announcements before we get started? Well then, brothers and sisters, as God's people, let's worship Him together. Jesus said, Father, forgive these people. They don't know what they're doing. That was our first reading. Last week we looked at when Jesus replied to him, I promise that today you will be with me in paradise. Our second reading. And today, when Jesus saw his mother and his favorite disciple with her, he said to his mother, "This man is now your son." Then he said to the disciple, "She is now your mother." From then on, the disciple took her into his own home. Our third reading. As we get started, and since I've got the real bulletin that we're using this week, let's all stand up and let's sing a song as we get into the worship service. Let's sing, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You.
Thank you.
standing, y'all may be seated, and would the two best-looking guys in the sanctuary this morning please come forward? Okay, Mark, come on up, Mark. Oh, my goodness gracious. Wait a minute. Well, I noticed, Grayson, you jumped right up when I said that. Here we are. Mm-hmm. Anything interesting happen this last week? Anything worth noting? Not really? Nothing?
Absolutely not.
Absolutely not. Nothing happened this last week. So in the vast scheme of things, this is a forgettable week.
Leap day.
Okay, leap day. What did you do on leap day? Jumped a lot?
Yeah.
Okay. That's, talk about it. I got a joke for you. Because it reminds me, what do you mean, oh no? What do you mean, oh no? I have quality humor here. When was leap day?
Thursday.
So that was February 29th. So March, Friday was, I asked my, on Friday, now get this, you're going to laugh so hard. This is going to be so funny. Get ready. You ready?
No.
Oh, sure, you ready to laugh? Oh, you ready to laugh, Grayson?
No.
Oh, it's going to be good. On Friday, I asked Debbie what day it was, and she said March 1st. And so I stomped around the room and said, what day is it? See, Jerry, the one with the mustache, he got it. You got it. You just don't think it's very funny. It's actually really sad, isn't it? Did you get it? March 1st. I marched around the room first, and then.
No, I didn't.
Okay, now you get it. Yeah. Be careful using this joke. It has power. Now, both of y'all are in. What's that?
That wasn't funny.
That wasn't funny. Well, you know, that's why people say I'm not nearly as funny as I think I am. That's one of those things. Okay, both of y'all do a lot of stuff, right?
No.
No, you don't do a lot of that. Well, you go to school, right? You both go to school.
Literally the only thing I do is go to school and play video games.
Okay, you go to, but that's something. You can identify with that. When he said that, you nodded your head. You go to school, right? You play video games, okay? And when you're playing video, but there's something else in which you're involved. I mean, you're involved in school, you're involved in video games, right? Sleeping, that's always nice.
Eating,
that's also. But I'll tell you, when you're sleeping and when you're eating, doing a lot of your eating, you're doing it at home, right? Okay, sometimes. Now, when you're at home, and you're eating. Are you alone at home? All by yourself? No, you're usually not alone. Who's with you when you're at home, Grayson? When you're eating? Who's there at home too?
My mom.
Your mom's there?
My dad.
Your dad's there? Your grandmother's there? Yeah, okay. Your grandmother's there? Okay, good. So, you see, when you're eating, who's there? Your mom's there? Your dad? Your lizards? You've got a... Well, you know, there's somebody maybe more important than your lizard who's also there.
No, he's upstairs.
Oh, he's upstairs. Okay. So he's in his room.
Yeah.
He doesn't count. Okay. He's not there when you're eating. Okay. Well, anyway. Yeah, you also have a dog. That's right. Now, what do we call when we look at people like mom, dad, grandma, brother?
No, he's upstairs.
He's upstairs. Okay. Lizard, dog. What do we call that group? Okay, we call it family. And in that family, we have all kinds of relationships. We got relationships with mom and dad and grandma and brother and lizards and dogs and all that stuff. And in that family, what does that family, what does that do for you? What does that do for us when we're a part of a family? What does it mean to be a part of a family? What does that family do? Okay, good. The family in that family, you love one another, right? Sometimes you get really mad. Marshall, we may need to talk later about this. But we love each other. We love one another in a family. Okay? What else is going on in the family? Well, the fact that you're eating, right?
Yeah.
Did you purchase the food that you're eating in the family?
Yeah.
Probably not. And so in families, people provide for us. We provide for one another. Right, in families. If you get really, really discouraged, really, really sad, and we got families that live outside the home. I mean, you got grandparents that care, right? When you get really sad and discouraged, you know, something really bad happens in school or something else, you know, you can go to your mom and dad or grandma or brother. Well, maybe not. But you could go to people in your family and you could tell them and they'll say nice things about you, right? They'll encourage you to keep trying, right?
Sometimes.
When you feel bad. Yeah, sometimes. Well, that's what we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking about this kind of relationship. And I want to tell you something. We've got families where we can feel love and where we can feel support and where people take care of us. But, you know, we're in a bigger family. Right now. Did you realize that? Right now, we're in a bigger family. And you know who are part of our family? Look around. You see the people out there? See the people out there? They're part of our family. Because they can do for us the same sort of stuff our moms and dads and grandmas and sometimes brothers do for us at home. They can love us and support us and encourage us when we're discouraged. And that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about the relationship we have with one another in this family that God's given us. So that's what we're going to focus on. So let's bow our heads, have a word of prayer, and then Jordan was going to hand me those papers and y'all can go on back. So let's bow our heads. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us families in which we can find support and care and maybe most important of all, love. We thank you for that and help us to always appreciate it and help us to be involved in it. So while people show support and care and love to us, help us to show support and care and love for them too. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. Okay, gentlemen, stand on your feet. Please stand. I want you gentlemen to have an outstanding week. And what do I want you to remember all week long? God does. God does love us. Thank you. And he's got stuff that you can use to draw and write over there. Now, I know I did it. I don't know why I've got three of last week's bulletins underneath the pulpit. I need to get those out. We come to the part of the service when we have the opportunity to lift our prayers to God. Now, we've got some particular needs in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. Are there any additions or updates of any of the folks on that list? Yeah, Barb. Okay. So Corbin has bad ear, sore throat, maybe coming down with something. Not a good thing to have happen when you're in college and studying and doing that sort of stuff. So we want to lift Corbin up in our prayers. So thank you. Anything else? Yes. Oh.
She's now in the hospital recovering. So we'd
like to have her. Absolutely. What's her name?
Jane.
So we'll lift Jane up in our prayers.
Jane was a leap year baby. So she got to spend her birthday in the hospital.
That's awful because she doesn't have many.
That's right.
You know, well, so yes, we want to lift Jane up in our prayers. Anything else we want to remember? Yes. Okay. Well, that's Country Springs. It's a nice place. Yeah, it really is a nice place. She'll see her room. Well, that'll be nice, you know. But I'm sorry to hear that because that was.
She was a little disappointed, but not as bad as what we thought she was.
Mm-hmm.
But I think maybe she was.
The doctor was. Oh. Okay. I gotcha.
The other thing is prayers for the Amish
Jordan. Yes, Jordan showed me that on his phone.
That's a bad, very bad situation. The guy, he was in a bitter rage over visitation for children. And Amish family had adopted children. And he went to the address of the people that adopted him.
Wow. And she was expecting, too. Yeah.
And a 4-year-old little boy seemed wrong towards his dad.
Wow. Terrible thing. Terrible thing. Absolutely. So we want to lift that whole family. And not just family, but whole community up in our prayers because that sort of resonates through it. So thank you. Thank you. Anything else we want to remember? Yes. Your aunt? Letrus. We want to lift her up in our prayers. Okay, thank you. Anything else? Well, then let's go to God in prayer, and I'll open and pray for a little bit. Then you all will have the opportunity to lift your concerns to God, and then we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So let's go before God now in prayer. Lord God, before we say anything else, we got to thank you for giving us the opportunity to be here this morning. It's a wonderful opportunity to share in your presence and to feel your love through your people. So thank you, Lord. We certainly appreciate that. Now, in just a little bit, we're gonna hear your word read and proclaimed. And as we prepare to do that, there's something that we need to confess. Although you've called us all into to families, and some of the families are biological, and some of the families are social, and some of the families are spiritual. But sometimes we don't function in those families in a very caring and compassionate way. Sometimes we're a little bit harsh, whether we're talking about our biological brothers and sisters or our spiritual brothers and sisters. We're not as kind or as gentle as we could be. We don't offer the support that they may need because we don't listen very well to what they need. And we're slow in showing them love that we all desperately crave for. And so when we fail to be the kind of people you've created us to be, and when we fail to show what brothers and sisters need to show to one another, we ask for your forgiveness. And we also ask that you redirect our focus so that we really take full advantage of these wonderful opportunities we have to relate to those around us, people who are there to offer us concern and compassion and love as we go about our living. Help us to be willing to offer that to them as well. In the name of Christ, we pray. And now in the privacy of our own hearts, we're going to lift up to you the concerns that we heard shared. We're going to lift up to you those needs that are in the bulletin. And we're going to lay before you all those things that weigh heavy on our heart. Lord God, hear us as we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for listening to us. And of course, thank you for loving us as much as you do. But right now, thank you for forgiving us. And we believe we've been forgiven. And thank you for responding to our needs. And we believe that you will, because we've offered up these needs in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, would the ushers come forward to collect their offering?
There's a church in the valley by the Wildwood. No lovelier place in the dale. No spot is so dear to my childhood as the little brown church in the dale. How sweet on a clear Sabbath morning to listen to the clear ringing bell. Its tones so sweetly are calling, oh, come to the church in the vale. Oh, come, 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 come to the church in the wild. Church in the dale. No spot is so dear to my childhood as the little brown church in the vale. There close by the church in the valley lies one that I love so well. She sleeps, sweetly sleeps, neath the willow. Disturb not her rest in the vale. There close by the side of that loved one, neath the trees where the sweet flowers bloom, when the farewell hymn shall be chanted, I shall rest by her side in the tomb. Oh, come, 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 come to the church in the wildwood. Oh, come to the church in the dale. No spot is so dear to my childhood as the little brown church in the vale.
Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to make this offering to you. Guide and direct the leaders of this congregation, that it be put to good and effective use. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. Now, I've got to tell you, the beginning of last week was pretty good around the Rüdiger house. At least it was for me. And even though I wish I could stand up here and say, oh, it was spiritual reasons or religious reasons, holy reasons. It actually wasn't. You see, a week ago last Thursday, my family was together again, you know, just the way it used to be. And it was all because Maggie was able to come home from college for a few days. And even though we didn't do much as a group, I mean, both Debbie and I were working, and Maggie was scheduled to take two of her praxis exams. And as some of y'all know, Coco Chanel has a part-time job here at the church. It just felt right when the four of us were together. And I'm talking about at the same place at the same time. And I've got to tell you, whenever that happens, I can't help but remember just how important these relationships are. And you know, as I was telling the young men a little while ago, that's really what we're going to be focusing on this morning. And I'm talking about the kind of relationship suggested by something else Jesus Christ said from the cross. I mean, we've already talked about forgiveness. You know, the forgiveness we can hear when Jesus said, "Forgive these people, they don't know what they're doing." We've already talked about that. And then we consider just how important it was to everyone who values salvation when Jesus replied to that faithful criminal, "I promise that today you will be with me in paradise." Now, that's what we've done over the last couple of weeks. And this morning, we're going to look at something else Jesus said after he had been lifted up on the cross, this time as described in the Gospel of John. Now, this is what the evangelist wrote. Jesus' mother stood beside the cross with her sister and Mary, the wife of Clopas. Mary Magdalene was standing there too. When Jesus saw his mother and his favorite disciple with her, he said to his mother, "This man is now your son." Then he said to the disciple, "She is now your mother." From then on, the disciple took her into his own home. Now, that's what happened. And I'll tell you, when Jesus spoke both to Mary and to his favorite disciple, I think Jesus was doing a whole lot more than just making new living arrangements for his mother. You see, during this crucifixion, his crucifixion, what Jesus was doing was he was actually reshaping and redefining the relationship that Mary and this beloved disciple had. But I'll tell you, in a broader sense, I think he was actually creating something that hadn't existed before. He was putting together a new family. Now, that's what I think his words were all about. And I'll tell you something. I believe those words and that meaning is just as relevant for us today as they were almost 2,000 years ago. And so with that in mind, we're going to spend a little bit of time this morning talking about the new family that Jesus was creating as he hung there on the cross. And right now I'm talking about the family of God, the body of Christ, us. You see, we're going to take this relationship that Jesus talked about, and we're going to consider three things that this new family can offer us as we do the best we can to follow Jesus Christ and apply his words and his example to our lives. Now, that's the plan. That's what we're going to be doing. But before we move ahead on this, there are a few things that I feel the need to mention first. For example, we're talking about a perfect family here. And how many of y'all lived, grew up, or had a perfect family? Just raise your hand. Go ahead. Okay. My wife raised her hand. I didn't see, other than Debbie, I didn't see a lot of hands go up. And, you know, I'll tell you why. Because I'm not sure perfection is possible in this lifetime. I don't think it's possible in the world as it is. I mean, when I was growing up, I think we had a good family. I grew up in a good family, probably better than most. But perfect, it wasn't. And if you have any doubt about that, just talk to my sister. You know, there's no perfect family. And I tell you that I think that applies to our family here as well. You know, the one that we call the church. And so when I suggest some of the things our new familial relationships might offer us, I'll tell you, it might be better to take it as much as a challenge as a reality. And as to the three things that I believe the family of God can offer us, I don't want any of y'all to leave here thinking I am giving some kind of exhaustive list, as though it's only three things that the church offers to us, because there's a whole lot more than that. Still, I believe these three benefits that the body of Christ, I believe that's what the church was established to provide for its members, you know, for us. For instance, I believe the body of Christ, the family of God, can offer unity. And I'm talking about a sense of harmony and oneness that's greater than the brothers and sisters themselves. Now, for me, this is the first thing that we can find within the church, or at least should be able to find. As a matter of fact, I believe we can see this very thing in a couple of passages in Scripture. For example, I want you to listen to what John wrote in his first letter. This is what John wrote. Think how much the Father loves us. He loves us so much that he lets us be called his children, as we truly are. But since the people of this world did not know who Christ is, they don't know who we are. My dear friends, we are already God's children, though what we will be hasn't yet been seen. But we do know when Christ returns, we will be like him because we will see him as he truly is. This hope keeps us, this hope makes us keep ourselves holy, just as Christ is holy. Now that's what John wrote in his letter. And according to the Apostle Paul, God's Spirit doesn't make us slaves who are afraid of him. Instead, we are his children and call him our Father. God's Spirit makes us sure that we are his children. His Spirit lets us know that together with Christ, we will be given what God has promised. We'll also share in the glory of Christ because we have suffered with him. I am sure that we are suffering now. What we are suffering now cannot compare with the glory that will be shown to us. In fact, all creation is eagerly waiting for God to show who his children are. You see, in this new family, there's only one head of the household, right? There's only one lord of the manor. There's only one king of the hill. I mean, even though there may be all kinds of kids running around, there's only one father in this family, right? And that needs to be our focus. You know, to be the family, in fact, this is the reason we are here. To be the family of God, God needs to be our focus. And you know, because of that, because God is the focus, within this family, I think we're able to feel a sense of harmony and oneness despite our differences. We're all looking at the same one, the same Father. I mean, even though we come from a whole lot of different places, and we speak a whole lot of different languages, I mean, none of the people I grew up with sound like y'all. And even though we have all kinds of different opinions and all kinds of different talents and abilities, even though we are different, we can all work together, can't we? Because we're all serving one King and one Lord and one Father. And in this way, I believe we can experience a sense of unity. And in my opinion, that's the first thing the family of God offers. And second, I think it also offers all kinds of encouragement. And I'm talking about support and hope for all of us children as we try to do the very best we can with what we got. I'm telling you, when it's firing on all cylinders, I believe this is exactly what the body of Christ can provide for us. And I'll tell you something else. I think that's what Paul was talking about when he wrote this to Timothy. Don't correct an older man. For purely personal reasons, I'm going to repeat that. Don't correct an older man. Somebody say amen. Yeah, that wasn't said with enthusiasm, but that's okay. Encourage him as you would your own father. Treat younger men as you would your own brother. Treat older women as you would your own mother. Show the same respect to younger women that you would show your sister. Take care of any widow who is really in need. Now that's what Paul said. And according to the writer of the letter to the Hebrews, we should keep on encouraging each other, to be thoughtful and to do helpful things. Some people have given up the habit of meeting for worship, but we must not do that. We should keep on encouraging each other, especially since you know the day of the Lord's coming is getting close. You know, in this ideal, in this perfect family, we really need to be encouraging one another. And we really need to be strengthening one another. And we really need to be building one another up, right? And this is something we can do through the lessons that we teach. I tell you, I don't know that there's anything more encouraging than the Word of God. And we can do it through the examples that we set. And we can do it through the sensitivity that we show. And I'll tell you, when we're successful, when we're successful within this family into which we were called, and when we're successful encouraging and strengthening and building one another up, man, not only are they going to change, we're going to change. I mean, instead of stagnating in all our assumptions and presumptions and prejudices, our perspectives have got to shift. And our vision has got to expand. And our relationship, oh my goodness gracious, our relationship with our father and with our brothers and sisters, man, they've got to deepen. In other words, we'll be moving closer to the kind of men and women we were created to be. Because we're doing what it was intended to do. This new community can be the source of some genuine encouragement. And for me, that's the second thing the family of God offers. And third, I also believe, and Marshall, what was it you said about families? What do we get in families? That's right, love. I think that's the third thing that the family of God offers. And I'm talking about the kind of love that isn't distracted by specific tastes or preferences. And it's not directed towards specific individuals with whom we agree and in whom we've decided to trust. No, I'm talking about a kind of love that's more like what Jesus talked about when he gave this command to his disciples. He said, "My children, I will be with you for only a little while longer. You will look for me, but you won't find me. I tell you, just as I told the people, you cannot go where I'm going. But I'm giving you a new command. You must love each other just as I have loved you. If you love each other, everyone will know you are my disciples." And as the Apostle Paul wrote to the Colossians, God loves you and has chosen you as his own special people. So be gentle, kind, humble, meek, and patient. Put up with each other and forgive anyone who does you wrong, just as Christ has forgiven you. Love is more important than anything else. It is what ties everything completely together. You see, as I read these two passages, the kind of love that both Jesus and Paul talked about, well, it's more like an atmosphere. More like an atmosphere than a bunch of specific individual actions. I mean, it seems as though the relationships that we have and share within this body are supposed to be shaped by our decision to be gentle and kind, to be humble and meek, to be patient and magnanimous to everybody. And it's shown by our determination to do exactly what Christ told us to do. And I'm talking about loving each other as we've been loved. Now, that's the atmosphere I'm talking about. And you know, when it's present, when that decision has been made and that determination has been set, and when we're involved in making this family, as loving as it can be, I believe two remarkable things are going to happen. I mean, on one hand, fewer of our brothers and sisters, and that's what we are, brothers and sisters. Fewer of our brothers and sisters are going to feel shame and fear and loneliness. While on the other hand, more members of our family will have the confidence and the faith to move forward, trusting that if the worst should happen and man, we fall flat on our faces, not unlike you when you're chasing Bella down the street, the love offered by both the Father and his children will not change. And I think that's the third thing the family of God offers. Now, remember how I told you that Maggie was down last week and how, for me, that just plain felt right? Well, she went back to Morgantown on Tuesday. And even though, from what I hear, she's coming back at the end of this week to celebrate. Marcy, I think she's coming back to celebrate your birthday. I know she's coming back for a birthday, so I assume it's your, what's that? She's coming back for Debbie's birthday. Is Debbie's birthday coming up? Oh, my goodness gracious. She's coming back for Debbie's, to celebrate Debbie's birthday. I'll tell you, it is always sad to see her go. Always sad to see her go. But here's the good news, at least for me. When she's gone, I believe I can still say, I am truly a family guy. You see, when Jesus saw his mother and favorite disciple with her, he said to his mother, "This man is now your son." Then he said to the disciple, "She is now your mother." From then on, the disciple took her into his own home. Now that's what happened. And I'll tell you, when I hear those words, I'm reminded that right here and right now, we are part of a different kind of family. One that was established to offer unity and encouragement and love to us, God's children. You see, as we approach Easter, this is the word of relationship we can remember and we can claim. Amen. Let's pray together. Almighty God, thank you so much for giving us these powerful words. Remind us that you have brought us into this new kind of family with different kind of people. People with whom we can feel a sense of unity. People that can encourage us just like we can encourage them. People that in this place have the capacity and the ability to establish an atmosphere of love. Thank you so much for bringing us into this, your family. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Now, one of the things that God offers us as members of this family is he's all given us opportunities to share in his presence in special ways. I mean, we can feel close to God when we go to God in prayer. We feel a closeness. We can feel a closeness to God when we're worshiping together, singing hymns and hearing messages and praying. We feel close to God. But when we gather around the table, when we gather around the Lord's table, that's the opportunity to share a closeness in a special way. Because not only are we sharing a closeness with one another, because we're gathered together around the table, but we're sharing a special closeness with him. You see, Jesus put a huge emphasis on the importance of sharing meals together. In fact, his whole vision for the future is centered around a banquet at which people from north and south, east and west are going to be invited and share with him when his kingdom comes. This is a foretaste of that banquet. And so if you see meaning at the table, you know, significance in the bread and the cup, feel free, join with us as we celebrate God's presence. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, as we approach your table, we want to offer you thanks and praise. My goodness gracious, we want to thank you for all that you've done in the past. We've learned a lot about ourselves, and more particularly, we've learned a lot about you in the way you cared for your people. I mean, you guided them through all their troubles. You guided them through a wilderness. You guided them into the promised land. You guided them as they established themselves. And even though repeatedly they turned away from you and did their own thing, you never abandoned them. Now, they paid the consequences for their actions, because you don't excuse consequences, but you always were with them and you always loved them. That never, ever changed. And for that, we give you great thanks. And now as we approach Easter, we have to thank you for your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Through him, you did something truly remarkable. You entered our time and space so that we could better understand you, and so that you could more closely identify with us. And when he died on that cross, we died too. And the power that sin had to distort our thoughts, to control our minds, man, that power was broken. And then we could make truly decisions. We could make decisions on our own. And when you caused him to rise from the dead, you gave us a glimpse into our future. And Lord God, for that, we give you great thanks and praise. And for that Holy Spirit that is present right now, that Spirit that is flowing through us and around us, bringing us together as your children into this family, opening our eyes so that we can see, and our minds so that we can understand, and our hearts so that we can feel. We offer you incredible thanks and praise. And so as we gather around your table as brothers and sisters, as your children, we offer thanks to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, on the night in which Christ was betrayed, after he had shared a very simple meal with his disciples, he took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you." In the same way, after they had shared the bread, he took the cup, and into the cup he poured the wine. And he said to them, "This cup represents the new covenant sealed by my blood. As often as you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you remember my death until I come again. Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, grant us your peace." Remember, the body of Christ was given for you. Remember the blood of Christ was shed for you. Almighty God, thank you. Thank you for giving your children the opportunity to share in your presence in this special way. We truly are family here. Help us to take that unity and that encouragement and that atmosphere of love out into the world. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, let's close the service by singing together, In Christ There Is No East or West. I want to thank Heather and Mark and Deb and Bob for serving communion, and Deb for doing such a good job setting it up. Of course, I want to thank Scott. Wonderful job on the piano. Dan, outstanding work on the board. Keeping me in check. Keeping me focused. Thank you, Jordan. Brothers and sisters. Go now in peace. And remember, right here, you are part of a family. We have a relationship with one another as brothers and sisters. And so just like I prayed after the communion, be challenged to take the unity that can be here and the encouragement that we can offer and receive and that atmosphere of love out into the world. And to empower this walk, receive the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the people of God said, Amen.
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 There's revival and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart.
Over there.
A Sunday morning.
Oh.
Hallelujah. And it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's the rhythm of a gospel song. Oh, once you choose it, you can't lose it. There ain't nothing there. I'm Got a sweet salvation, and it's beautiful.